This is the beauty of Jesus. It does not matter who you are. The gospel is for you. You know, some people say, well, there's a special type of person who will receive the gospel. No. When you look at what happened just in this chapter, you realize that the gospel is for absolutely everybody. And it doesn't matter who you are. It doesn't matter what you're trapped in. It doesn't matter what kind of attitude that you have. Jesus is the most beautifying force in the universe. And he brings them all together. And that's so incredibly wonderful. Hi, everybody. It's Ken Taylor. I am so glad that you're here today, whether you're watching at our Kitchener campus watch party or our Waterloo watch party, or whether you're watching through our online campus. We trust and pray and long that you will draw closer to God than you've ever been before as a result of being with us today. Hey, I want to start out with just a simple statement that goes like this. God is ever, only, always the initiator. God is ever, only, always the initiator. Or let me expand it this way. When it comes to finding and knowing and experiencing a relationship with God, the initiator, the first mover, the one reaching out to us is ever, only, always God. When it comes to a relationship with God, God starts it every single time. Now, back in 1893, there was a guy by the name of Francis Thompson who wrote a poem that has a rather strange title to it, because the poem is about God, and the poem was called The Hound of Heaven. Now, Thompson himself was a man who experienced tremendous poverty, and he actually had an addiction to opioids. But what he does in this poem is he describes this idea that God is the one who pursues us. And I want to read to you some of the poem. You've likely heard it before. It goes like this. I fled him. Down the nights and down the days, I fled him down the arches of the years. I fled him down the labyrinthian ways of my own mind. And in the midst of tears, I hid from him. And under running laughter, up vistaed hopes I sped, and shot precipitated adown titanic glooms of chasmed fears. From those strong feet that followed after, but with unhurrying chase and unperturbed pace, deliberate speed, majestic instancy, they beat, and a voice beat, more instant than the feet. And on he goes to describe the fact that God was pursuing him. 182 lines of this incredible poem. And Francis Thompson's expression of the way that God pursues us is actually something that comes from the Bible. If you open up the pages of the Bible, what you'll discover is from the opening chapters that God is the one who initiates a relationship with human beings. The first couple rebel against him, run and hide, and yet it's God who steps down into the garden and looks for them. And in the ensuing pages of Scripture, as we work our way all the way through the Old Testament into the New Testament, we see God time after time after time, when people run from him and reject him and rebel against him, that in his grace and his love for us, he keeps pursuing us. All the way to the point, the ridiculous point, that God actually becomes one of us, a human being, forever human, to live among us. And Jesus goes to the cross and takes that rebellion on himself and takes our sin and fights sin and death and rises from the grave, opening a way for us to have a forever relationship with God. This is the story of Scripture. God is the one who pursues us. Over and over and over again, he's the one who does that. If you remember in the book of Acts, what we have is the first chapter, Jesus calls his 120 followers together and says to them, go wait in a room for me, the Holy Spirit to come. And so they go to Jerusalem, they get into a room, and for about 10 days they wait, and then the Holy Spirit shows up, the sound of a wind, flames on their head, and they pour out into the streets and they begin to tell people, God's using them to share the message, to reach out, to open a relationship. They tell people about Jesus and the resurrection. And 3,000 people on that very day follow Jesus, the church. It's a mega church from day one. And thousands of people are added to the church in the days that follow. But as the movement grows, like all movements do, it receives a lot of pushback and persecution begins to start. And many of the believers who are followers of Jesus need to go out from Jerusalem to different places just to survive. Among the enemies of the early Christians is a man by the name of Paul, or that time his name is Saul. And he gets papers to go to Damascus to get Christians and throw them into prison. But on his way, he encounters the risen Jesus, and Saul converts to Christianity. He follows Jesus. He becomes this adamant follower of Jesus. And for the next number of years, he studies the scriptures, the Old Testament. He works with the apostles until at one point they call him and Barnabas and others to go on a missionary trip. And off they go around the Mediterranean basin, report back to the church at Antioch what had happened to them. And they celebrate it, and it was just been a great experience. After months of resting and recharging and renewing, Paul decides to go on his second missionary journey. But the problem is that he and Barnabas get into some kind of a conflict, and that conflict causes them to part ways. So on the second journey, Paul goes with a man named Silas and Luke, the author of the book of Acts, and Timothy and others on the second missionary journey. But I want you to watch as you look in chapter 16, the hand of God moving them, the touch of God reaching out into people's lives, how God orchestrates what they want to do. They've put some plans together. They've decided this is the journey, this is the approach they're going to make into new territory. But watch how God responds. Watch how God moves them. So you come to Acts chapter 16, and I want you to look at verse 6. Acts chapter 16, look at verse 6. It says this: Paul and his companions traveled throughout the region of Phrygia and Galatia, having been kept by the Holy Spirit from preaching the word in the province of Asia. Closed door. Watch this. When they came to the border of Mysia, they tried to enter Bithynia, but the Spirit of Jesus would not allow them to. Ding, another closed door. Look at this. So they passed by Mysia and went down to Troas. During the night, Paul had a vision of a man of Macedonia standing and begging him, come over to Macedonia and help us. Open door. After Paul had seen the vision, we got ready at once to leave for Macedonia, concluding that God had called us to preach the gospel to them. God is directing. He's pushing these missionaries into a particular place. It's part of God's strategy to reach out, because he's ever, always, only the initiator. Here's what we read in verse 11. From Troas, we put out to sea, sailed straight for Samothrace, and the next day we went on to Neapolis. From there, we traveled to Philippi. And chapter 16 of the book of Acts is all about Philippi. It's a Roman colony and the leading city of that district of Macedonia, and we stayed there for several days. Now, last Sunday, we opened up chapter 16 and looked at the first half of it. Chapter 16 in the book of Acts is about the missionary's journey to the city of Philippi. And in chapter 16, we find three individuals that the missionaries encounter, and through them, God touches these people's hearts, and we believe they respond to the gospel as a result of that. One of the things that we were doing last Sunday is we were asking ourselves, how is it? We asked a couple of questions around these individuals. We said, what approach did God use to touch their hearts and awaken them to their need to trust in Jesus? If God's always the initiator, how does he initiate this touch in these people's lives? And we said the second question was this one: which door did they open up to respond to the gospel? There's lots of ways that God touches our lives. I shared them from a reading just earlier. But we also have to respond with a door a door that opens up. It could be an intellectual door. It could be a relational door. It could be an emotional door. It could be an experiential door. There are a number of doors that we would open up to sort of hear or listen to, respond to God's touch in our lives. And what we are trying to do in this series, among other things, at least, in these 2 weeks in Acts 16, is move the questions from off the pages of Scripture into our own hearts and ask this question: how did God reach out to me? What kinds of ways did God reach me? If I'm a follower of Jesus, if I've made that decision to trust in him as my sin forgiver and life leader, well, what kinds of things did God do to touch me? Was it people? Was it a book, a song? What was it like? And the second question is, what door did I open to respond to his touch and turn in faith toward Jesus? Was it an intellectual door, relational door, experiential door, and so on and so forth? What door did God use to touch our lives? And we said this would be kind of, I think it can be helpful for us to understand and look back and realize just how much God was interested in us. Last week we looked at two people. There was Lydia, who was a seller of purple. She's a businesswoman. She owned a boutique in Philippi. She hobnobbed with all the wealthy and elite people. She had a Bible study with a bunch of other women down by the river. Paul came and Silas came and the others came and they shared Jesus in a likely an apologetics way, because that's what Paul was doing in the book of Acts when he presents Christ. And she, through her mental, logical mind, received him. That's the door that she opened. Then we looked at another girl whom we named the Python girl. And if you don't know why we did that, you have to go back and watch last Sunday. And she was possessed by a spirit, and Paul did a power encounter. That's how the touch of God went on her life. A power encounter, and the spirit left her. And while the text doesn't tell us that she became a follower of Jesus, I think it's fair to say that I'm going to tell you, I lean in the direction that she did, and I'm going to kind of move in that direction for the rest of this time. Most Bible teachers do. I believe that this experience of being freed from this oppressive spirit opened the door for her to respond to Jesus in her own heart. Well, today we come to the third one, the last one in Acts chapter 16. And but before we get to them, we need to kind of work our way through the passage. You see, once Paul and Silas removed the spirit from this girl, well, the owners of this girl, who were making all kinds of money off her because she was telling the future, she was a fortune teller, they were making all kinds of money off her, all of a sudden, they were without a business. And here's what you read happened. When her owners realized that their hope of making money was gone, they seized Paul and Silas and dragged them into the marketplace to face the authorities. Now, that word for marketplace is the word agora. And in Philippi, as typically in that day, the marketplace or the agora was an area in which there was a marketplace, market food, much like St. Jacob's Market or downtown Kitchener's Market. It was also a place for unemployed people to hang out to look for work. It was a place for healing. It was a social or community center, but it was also a place of legality. That was a place of where the magistrates or the lawyers or the judges hung out as well. They brought them, they brought Paul and Silas before the magistrates and said, "These men are Jews and are throwing our city into an uproar by advocating customs unlawful for us Romans to accept or practice." So they're saying two things about them. Number one, they've thrown the city up into an uproar. That was not true, okay? And you'll notice that these men are Jews. They point out that they're Jews. There was an emperor, Claudia, who had just around this time asked all of the Jews to be expelled from Rome. And so there was an anti-Semitism, a racism towards Jews at this point, and that may have been what you're catching right here. Now, the fact that they advocated customs unlawful for Romans to accept their practice is actually true. You needed to worship according to the ways that Rome officially recognized. Now, the law was there. It wasn't really imposed that strictly, but clearly they were, in fact, violating that law. The crowd joined in the attack against Paul and Silas, and the magistrates ordered them to be stripped and beaten with rods. There were these police officer-like people called lictors, and the lictors had these rods. They were bound in they were bound together, and they carried them with them. And the rods were a symbol of justice and law. And what's happening here is they've asked them to take these rods and beat Paul and Silas. This will be one of three times that Paul will experience a beating from these rods. They would have been bleeding. It's possible they would have had cracked ribs at this particular point. Verse 23, after they had been severely flogged, severely flogged. They were thrown into prison, and the jailer was commanded to guard them carefully. When he received these orders, he put them in the inner cell and fastened their feet in the stocks. So we're introduced to the third person, Lydia, Python girl, and now the jailer. That's all we know about his identity. Now, as a jailer in that day, if you were a jailer, typically you're ex-military. You are someone who has been in the army, and now you're like really old. You've gotten, you know, you're weak, you can't keep up, you're somewhere like really old, you're probably like in your mid-40s, okay? And at this particular point, you've maybe got some battle wounds, maybe you're limping, you've seen battles, maybe missing a few fingers. That's the kind of person that you are. This guy, from everything we can understand, was a mean guy, a brutal kind of a guy. As you'll see, when he receives the orders, he put them in the inner cell and fastened their feet in the stocks. Now, we know a little bit later that the magistrates only put them in jail overnight. They were just holding them away so that the crowd could, you know, dial down the anger that they had toward them, and so that they could act like they were in control. It was only one night stay. You'll see that a little bit later. But this guy goes way beyond and above what he should have done. He doesn't clean their wounds. He doesn't put oil on their cuts and so on and so forth. He puts them in the inner cell, which is likely the place where there is no windows, no light whatsoever, where it would have been dark. It would have been thick air. It would have been, you know, rot, stench filled and all of that. But not only does he do that, but he puts them in stocks. Now, you may be thinking of stocks like you think of handcuffs as a way of sort of holding or suppressing a person's freedom, but the stocks were actually instruments of torture. What they would do is they would splay out the legs, so spread your legs as far as they could, put them in these locks, and what would happen is that that you would experience tremendous deep throbbing cramps in your legs as you sat there for this length of time. So this guy is not Mr. Nice Guy at all. He's kind of like a middle class guy who's moving toward retirement, but he's seen a lot of blood and war and horror, and that's the kind of temperament that he has. Verse 25, about midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God, and the other prisoners were listening to them. Now I want you to think about what's happening here. Here are these men who are in these stocks, and they have been flogged severely, and they're celebrating God. You know, you and I can be controlled by and overwhelmed by our circumstances and see only our circumstances and how difficult they may be, or we can look at God and rise above our circumstances. And I know it's not always easy to do that, but here is a perfect example of these men going through such a difficult time and yet responding with this elevated seeing God above it all and embracing God in the midst of it. They knew that God had led them here. They didn't get it all. They didn't understand it all. They didn't recognize why it was happening the way that it was happening. But they believed that this is where they needed to be, and they knew that God was with them. And like Daniel in jail, these men in jail were going to celebrate and live in a way that would honor God. Now, I imagine the jailer heard them singing, heard them praying. By the way, the songs that they sang may have been Old Testament hymns. It's also possible in the book of Philippians, a letter that would be written later by Paul to the church in Philippi, there is a hymn in Philippians, a hymn that goes all the way back to the early days of the church, even likely before this missionary trip. It's possible that they were singing that hymn too. What happens is they're hearing all this, they're hearing them pray, and then the jailer happens to fall asleep. Here's what we read. Suddenly there was a violent earthquake, and the foundations of the prison were shaken. At once all the prisoners' doors flew open, and everyone's chains came loose. The jailer woke up, and when he saw the prison doors open, he drew his sword and was about to kill himself because he thought the prisoners had escaped. You know the rules in Rome, right? If you're a soldier and you guard somebody, the person escapes, you forfeit your life. He's going to take it. He doesn't all want to die publicly. He wants to take his life on his own. Verse 28, but Paul shouted, "Don't harm yourself. We are all here." The jailer called for lights, rushed in, fell trembling before Paul and Silas. He then brought them out and asked, "Sirs, what must I do to be saved? Sirs, what must I do to be saved?" Now, okay, I love to tell people about Jesus. And if you're a follower of his, you love to do it too. I have never had anybody come up to me and say to me, what must they do to be saved, out of the blue? Particularly somebody who just had abused me and spoken down to me or anything like that. And the question gets asked, how on earth does he come up with a question like this? What was it that caused him to say this? Now, some people will tell you that the reason that he's calling out like this is because he wants to be saved from losing his life because the prisoners have escaped. But the prisoners have not escaped. So that line of reasoning doesn't make sense to me. I think there are perhaps three reasons, maybe more, as to why the jailer says, sirs, what must I do to be saved? What must I do to be saved? Let me share them with you right now. One of them is that he has heard Paul and Silas talking about Jesus. He's heard them praying. He's heard them singing. And as he looks at them and hears the message and understands that that what they're saying, he wants that relationship with Jesus. A second reason is that he is actually afraid of God. You see, he is tying the earthquake to these men. And he knows that these men, that he brings those two pieces together, rightly so, and recognizes that God is this amazing, amazing being who's powerful, and he doesn't want to fall underneath the judgment of God. And so what he does is he comes to them and he says to them, hey, listen, save me from the judgment of God. How do I get saved from that judgment? Let me give you a third reason as well. And this reason goes back to the context of what's happening in the Mediterranean basin at this particular time. And to do that, I'm going to go to the book of Galatians, and it goes like this in Galatians chapter 4 and verse 4. But when the set time had fully come, God sent his son. Now, Galatians is written by the Apostle Paul. This is the Apostle Paul's Christmas story in just a few words. When the set time had fully come, when the fulfilled time had come, when the right time had come, when the exact time came historically, God sent his son. Now, here's what's interesting. Historians look at the context of what's happening at this particular time, and they say it's a time like no other. That historically, when you look at it, it looks like God has put all the pieces in play for Jesus to come so that the message of salvation can go in a way it would never have been able to go before. For example, right now, there's a universal language, and that universal language is Greek. So if you're going to be a missionary, you don't have to learn another language. If you're going to write a book called the Bible, you can write it in one language, and that language is Greek, because it was a common language that the vast majority of people would have known. In fact, people in that day often knew three different languages. I would suggest that the Apostle Paul knew Aramaic, knew Hebrew, and knew Greek. And this was very common for them to know a number of languages. And this is how the table was set. Not only was there universal language, there was universal travel. You see, the Romans were really good at building roads. And if you've been anywhere over in either England or in Italy and so on, or other places, you would have seen and maybe walked on, as I have, roads that the Romans built 2,000 years ago. These roads were incredible roads. In fact, there were no fewer than 29 great military highways radiating from the capital and the late empire, okay? 113 provinces were interconnected by 372 great roads. The whole road system comprised more than 400,000 kilometers of roads, of which over 80,500 kilometers were paved with stone. Now think about that. Now the transmission of the gospel could travel much more quickly because they could move along these roads at high, high speed. Not only was that true, but there was a universal peace. Because Rome was responsible, there was this peace that was settled over the land. And it was a peace that, while there were skirmishes, it raised the economics and it allowed people to travel more freely. It was just something that was very, very special for them. And all of these things, plus one other that I want to share with you, and that's this. There was a universal hunger. And some historians will tell you that what was happening was that all of the gods weren't providing what the people thought they should. The immorality, which was very rampant from temple prostitution to men having mistresses with their wives to pedophilia, all those kinds of things that was happening. that there was this sense in which there was an emptiness in the world. There was like a universal emptiness. And there was a little line that was going on at that time. It basically was this: what do I need to be saved from this emptiness? Where can I find something to save me from this emptiness? Now, I don't know what the reasons were that completely know the reasons for the jailer saying, what must I do to be saved, okay? But whatever the reasons were, the answer that he was looking for was the answer that Paul and Silas gave him. And here's what you read. They replied, believe in the Lord Jesus and you will be saved, you and your household. Then they spoke the word of the Lord to him and to all the others in his house. So at that particular point, he's looking for some answer, and they give him Jesus. And this man responds to this. You need to believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. Here's what we read. At that hour of the night, the jailer took them. Okay, so he believes in the Lord Jesus Christ. And then here's what you find as evidence that shows up that, in fact, he did. It says, at that hour of the night, the jailer took them and washed their wounds. He's got this compassion and love for them. Here's a man who, just a little bit before, wants to brutalize them, and now he wants to heal them. Then immediately he and all his household were baptized. That's a second reason I believe that he's put his faith in Jesus. He's obedient to a call to demonstrate his faith in Christ by being baptized. Number three, the jailer brought them into his house and set a meal before them. Just like Lydia was hospitable, the jailer is hospitable. He invites them into his home as a way of showing hospitality and love toward them. And then finally, he was filled with joy because he had come to believe in God and his whole household. He's filled with joy. The man who just hours earlier was about to take his own life is now filled with joy because of his relationship with Jesus. It's interesting. He says to Paul and Silas, what must I do to be saved? And a lot of people think they have to do to be saved. But we don't spell Christianity do-o. We spell it do, D-O-N-E, done. It's all done by Jesus. It's not what you do. It's what he's done. And you reach out and put your faith and trust and hope in him. It's a great, great account of what happens. And it brings us back to the question that we asked about both Lydia and the Python girl. We need to ask it about the jailer. What approach did God use to touch the jailer's heart and awaken him to his need to trust in Jesus? And the answer, in my mind, is the faith of Paul and Silas and the experience of the earthquake. That in combination, they brought this man to a point where he realized that he needed something. He jumps into the jail in front of them. And the next question is, what door did the jailer open to respond to the gospel? And I would argue that he recognized that Paul and Silas had something he needed. It was the experience door. He saw them. He wanted that same experience in his own life. And so what you see in Acts chapter 16 is God moving. The first touch he's making in people's lives, whether it's Lydia in a Bible study down by the river outside the walls of the city of Philippi, or the Python girl who's shouting things at him, and God uses Paul to have a power encounter with her that throws out this spirit, or whether it be the jailer who's a brutal man who pushes away from God in so many ways and now sees and hears these men, and his response is to open his door of his heart to them. I want to keep going because there's some cool things that happen in the rest of the chapter. Watch this. When it was daylight, the magistrates sent their officers to the jailer with the order, please release those men. So their intent was to release them the next day, as I mentioned earlier. The jailer told Paul, the magistrates have ordered that you and Silas be released. Now you can leave. Go in peace. But it doesn't end there. Watch what Paul does. But Paul said to the officers, they beat us publicly without a trial, even though we are Roman citizens, and threw us into prison, and now do they want to get rid of us quietly? No. Let them come themselves and escort us out. Whew, watch this. The officers reported this to the magistrates, and when they heard that Paul and Silas were Roman citizens, they were alarmed. Here's the deal. You can't beat a Roman citizen. And you can't beat them, certainly, without a trial. These guys were on thin ice at this particular point. They could lose their jobs. And in fact, Philippi could lose some of its benefits from Rome. This was very, very serious. So why does Paul raise this at this particular point? Is it just a vengeful thing with him? They came, it says in verse 39, to appease them and escorted them from the prison, requesting them to leave the city. But Paul doesn't want to do that. He wants them to come. He wants them to be there. Why? Well, let me give you a reason. This is absolutely brilliant. Imagine if the starters of the church, Paul and Silas, left the city secretly, slinking out under a cloud of guilt. What would that have done to the new believers and their reputation in the town? Because now they're standing up for this, they're not only protecting their own reputation, they're protecting the reputation of that new group of people. These were Roman citizens who started this. This is a group now that won't be mocked in the same way they would have been had they slinked out of town or whatever that word's like. This was a brilliant, brilliant move on Paul's part. But watch this. After Paul and Silas came out of the prison, they went to Lydia's house where they met with the brothers and sisters and encouraged them. And then they left. I just find this verse so incredible. In fact, look at this line. Jesus is the most beautifying force in the universe. You know who's in that house? This is the first church in Philippi, meeting in Lydia's home. And who's in that house? Lydia and her household. Remember, they came to faith in Christ. The Python girl. Not only that, but the jailer and his household and others who've already followed Jesus. Now look at what's going on in this house, because this is really, really, I think, so wonderful. Jesus is the most beautifying force in the universe. And what you have in this home is such a diversity of those three people. You have Lydia, who's upper class, the Python girl, who's lower class, and the jailer, who's middle class. You actually have three different ethnic backgrounds. Lydia's from Thyatira, which is in Turkey, present-day Turkey. That's where she's from. She had moved, remember, to Philippi. Python girl is a Greek, and the jailer is a Roman. Lydia is very wealthy. The Python girl is very poor. The jailer, he's kind of in middle class. You start to look at these people and you realize the diversity is absolutely incredible. And these are the people that make up the first church. And I want to say to you and to me, this is the beauty of Jesus. It does not matter who you are. The gospel is for you. You know, some people say, well, there's a special type of person who will receive the gospel. No. When you look at what happened just in this chapter, you realize that the gospel is for absolutely everybody. And it doesn't matter who you are. It doesn't matter what you're trapped in. It doesn't matter what kind of attitude that you have. Jesus is the most beautifying force in the universe. And he brings them all together. And that's so incredibly wonderful. And if you start thinking about you and who you are, and then you start looking at the body of Christ, the church all around the world, you realize the ethnic diversity, the educational diversity, the social diversity, and you realize that Christianity, unlike every other world religion, if I could put it in that category, grows in the middle of all kinds of diverse contexts, all kinds of diverse cultural contexts. Jesus is the most beautifying force in the universe. And you and I, if you're a follower of Jesus, you get to be a part of that. You're part of that beautiful, beautiful body of Christ. I think it's awesome what happens in Acts chapter 16. And if you're here and you're listening to me and you know I've never made a decision to trust in Jesus, I want to tell you that God's touching your life right now through this message, through the worship, through everything else today, through friends, through whatever, creation, all those things. He's saying to you, I want you to put your faith in me. I want you to know that you matter to me, that I love you, and that I want you to put your trust in Jesus. Will you bow your heads with me? Father, thank you for Acts 16. Thank you for the stories of Lydia and this girl who was possessed by a spirit and the jailer. What diversity and yet what unity happens as a result of their faith in Christ. And I pray, Heavenly Father, that we would be so caught up with the wonder that you're the God who reach to us. And if we're followers of Jesus, it was a special touch that you made in our lives that we responded to. I pray that we'd celebrate that, and that we'd recognize more and more the wonder of what it means to be part of your family. And I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless.
Let me start with a question, Ken, that we got actually from the last service. We didn't have a chance to answer it yet. Here's a question. How do you know in your own life that the closed doors are God's decision? So Paul experiences, right, there's like this boundary being set where he's not to go into this into these different places. And so how do you know that it's God that's setting that door and not the works of the devil or the or the evil, or maybe even in your own mind.
Yeah,
so how do you differentiate those?
And that is a great question, and that is kind of a question that sits within the boundaries of a lot of questions where people ask about God's will. What is God's will for my life? It kind of fits into that category.
Yes.
I would say that I'll do two responses to it. One of them is that if you're trying to decide whether this is a closed door or whether you just need to push a little harder on it, I think you need to you need to pray about it. I think you need to bring other people into the conversation that you trust and value. I think that you also need to ask questions like, why is the door closed? And if another one opens, is that even a right direction for me to go? But I also would just temper that a little bit by saying that this is a really unique thing that we see here in Acts 16, that it isn't like God is always doing this.
Yeah.
And I think for the most part, people tend to want God to, you know, how is it the right car, God? Tell me if this is the right car. Is this the right house? Should I be going to this university? And we have all those questions like God's, you know, going to constantly be telling us everything to do. And I think we go way overboard on that. Mm-hmm. It's rare in Scripture that that happens. I think God would ultimately say to us, be wise, be submissive, and make good decisions. I really think that's the best answer. In this particular case, they just couldn't do it. Like, it wasn't like they could push on the door. It, you know, the statements are quite strong, right, about how that happens.
Yeah, I'm with you. I think God wants us ultimately to learn his heart, so that then we can be like him without him needing to tell us every step along the way. Mm-hmm. I think that's when he gets maybe the most glory from us.
Yeah.
When we're actually being like Jesus without needing to be told, do this.
Yeah.
Like, it's like coming from within us.
Yeah. There's lots of options. Pick one of the best ones and, you know, delight yourself in the Lord and he'll give you the desires of your heart. It kind of means delight yourself in the Lord and your desires will line up with his desires, and then just make your choices. I think we have to be careful that we don't ask God for, you know, I think he's just saying, be mature and make a decision, you know.
Yeah, and I think the way that we get better at discernment and hearing his voice too is through the repetition or the rhythm of it. So so if you live most of your life not listening for God's voice, not listening for his leading, and then something comes up and you go, okay, God, tell me what to do. Yeah. You have like no practice in it, right? Like you're not close to him, and then suddenly you're like, hey, God, tell me what to do.
Yeah.
So I think the more that we walk with God every day, you learn what his voice sounds like, and you learn what like those leanings sound like. Mm-hmm. So that'd be my kind of take on it.
Yeah.
So kind of in the same vein, a similar question, why did God move them to Philippi? And so why didn't he allow them to go into Bithynia, Troas, into Asia?
Yeah.
Do we know why?
Like, I obviously, this is a bit of a guess. We don't know why the doors were closed there, but some of our suspicions are that Philippi was the capital of Macedonia, that there were people who were ripe and ready to receive the gospel, like Lydia. She's right there studying. Mm-hmm. And that this would become a central point to sort of for the gospel to go in greater and more effective ways. It's a strategic move to move the gospel forward. And so that's basically why I believe that Philippi is the better choice of any other option. And that's really why that leading happened like that.
Cool. That makes sense.
Yeah. So I think
the strategic move of God.
Yeah, exactly.
Eventually reach those people.
Yeah.
Okay, here's a question. G'day, Pete and Ken. So why did Paul wait to pull out his I'm a Roman citizen card?
Okay.
Why did he do that later? So, because he allows him and Silas to be beaten and jailed.
Yeah.
And then he says, oh, by the way, because if he would have done that earlier, he presumably wouldn't have been beaten.
Yeah,
or put in jail.
For sure. Yeah, for sure he wouldn't have been beaten, because that was wrong to do it. It was wrong to do it without a trial. And as I mentioned in my teaching, this was a very, very dangerous thing. These guys could lose their jobs, and Philippi itself could, you know, not experience some of the benefits it was experiencing as a result of what they did. Roman citizenship was really important. Mm-hmm. I think there may be a number of options. One, he just never thought about it under the moment with the pressure that was happening. Although I don't like that answer. I think it is an option.
Because then Silas would have been like, dude!
Exactly.
Why didn't you tell it?
Where was your head? And the other option is that the crowd was just so boiled up with anger and the mob violence that maybe he was expressing it and nobody was hearing it. You know, everything moved really quickly. The third option, which I think makes sense, but really shows the genius of Paul, is that he felt, if they are going to beat us, we'll let them beat us, and that will actually be to the benefit of the believers in Philippi, because they mistreated us. They violate what we are as Roman citizens. It gives great, everybody will now know that, you know, they'd violated that, and it will give them greater credibility, greater safety. No one's going to pick on the church. And so this just becomes a very strong statement for them.
Right, right. It gives them the upper hand in a sense. It's like, you mistreated us, now you're going to treat us even better.
Yes.
Okay. Here's another question. If someone says that I've never felt God reaching out to me, because you talked about God being the initiator, he's always moving, reaching out to us, could that be true? Could it be true that God isn't actually reaching out to them?
Mm-hmm.
So does God reach out to everybody?
Yeah, I think it's clear that God reaches out to everybody, whether that's through creation. Paul talks about that in Romans chapter 1, whether that's through creation or through our conscience or through people or through events, through that sense of emptiness. I talked about how the Roman Empire was in that spot, during this time frame. He does. I think I might ask, what exactly are you asking God to do? What exactly would it look like for you to say, God spoke to me? And I think sometimes I use the word nudge, because I think sometimes that's a better way of sort of getting the idea that it may not be vocal. It may just be sort of a pressing that you feel in your spirit or in your mind, and so on and so forth. And so, yeah, I think it's clear that he speaks to absolutely everybody.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And he speaks through us.
Yes, and through us.
And so if you were meeting someone and they said, I don't feel like God's reaching out to me, you could become the way that God is reaching out to them.
Yeah, he is right now.
Yeah. Yeah. And I also think sometimes too, when I think about, like, God is the initiator, that in Jesus for all time, he has made an initiation of dying on behalf of anyone who would put their trust in him.
Yeah,
and
exactly.
So that's just a reality that you could tell someone. It doesn't matter what you feel, what you're feeling, that's happened. Like, Jesus died for your sins if you want to put your trust in him.
Yeah.
That would be another way that I might look at it. Here's a question really about sharing our faith. What is apologetics, and is there a difference between apologetics and an evangelistic approach?
Oh, okay.
Evangelism,
good
apologetics.
Question. Yeah.
Yeah.
If we think of evangelism as me taking the good news about Jesus and sharing it with someone else, apologetics is a way of evangelism. It is a kind of a category of it. It is defending the faith. It's using logic or reason. And Paul would often do that by using the Old Testament scriptures, the prophetic scriptures about the Messiah. You know, he's going to be born in Bethlehem. Micah 5:2 talks about that. Or he's going to, you know, experience, you know, being, you know, he's going to he's buried in a rich tomb. There's a whole bunch of them, and my brain just fried for a moment.
You got overloaded.
But what he's doing, then he's saying, but Jesus did this. So he's sort of logically saying, this is the way that Christ came. Christ fulfilled all of these prophetic announcements, and that's an apologetic way of sharing the gospel.
Right, so it's like a systematic, rational way.
Yeah.
It's almost like that would be a helpful way for people that's the door that they're going to walk through.
Right.
And for other people, that's like, I'm not interested in that.
Yeah.
Sing me a song. Yeah. And that's the way.
And that's why I was talking about the doors in the series, to suggest that there are different doors that people might open. So for some people, it is the logical door. For some people, it's the experiential door. For some people, it's the relational door. Mm-hmm. And all of those things can come into play. And, you know, I'm even arguing that Lydia and the Python girl and the jailer have different doors that they're opening.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, there wasn't time for logic with the jailer. It was a totally different experience for him.
Right,
so,
right.
Yeah.
Okay, last question that we'll have time for this morning. So the jailer believed and was saved. God used the earthquake experience to change his heart. The Bible says that his household was saved as well.
Yeah.
Do you think that happened after the jailer went home and told them about his experience? Or did that happen right there when the jailer believed? So I'm assuming this person's reading the text and realizing it doesn't describe that the jailer went home and told his family.
Mm-hmm.
Is that probably what happened? Like,
yeah. I don't know. I think he may have taken Paul and Silas home and washed their wounds. And at that point, they shared the gospel with those people who were in the home.
Mm.
And they responded in faith to Christ at that moment. So that
right.
would be my guess.
Right. So, yeah, the reading of it as, and his family believed at the same, it's not like saying at the same time somehow. That wouldn't make sense.
No. And it's quite possible and likely that the jailer's home is right there. So it's not like they're down 18 blocks or a kilometer away.
Okay.
It's right there. He's sleeping there. So I think that you've got him, you know, just living there. And I think
so. They experienced the earthquake too.
Yeah, they would have experienced the earthquake too.
That's good. That makes sense.
Yeah.
All right.
Yep. Yeah.
we're almost out of time. Why don't you wrap us up here?
Hey, everybody. We're really glad that you've joined us for the series. And as we've spent some time talking through the book of Philippians, and we've ended up in chapter 16. We've got a little ways to go. We're excited about that whenever we get back to that, to the series again. But I'd like to pray and ask that God would bless our time today. Will you bow with me in prayer? Heavenly Father, thank you for the account in Acts 16 of Paul's faithfulness, Silas's faithfulness to you, and for the people who we see and understand put their faith in Jesus. We're sure there were lots more, but these snapshots are so important because they tell us, one, that you love everybody. It doesn't matter who we are, whether we're like a Lydia or like a jailer or like this young lady, that the gospel touches hearts and changes them. And it doesn't matter where we've been, and if we're listening or watching today and we're not a follower of Jesus, I hope people will know that it doesn't matter who they are or where they've been, that you love them and you care for them. Thank you for doing that, for especially talking to each of us and drawing us close to that point where we can make that decision. And I pray, Lord, your blessing would be on everyone. Thank you for being such a God of great love and care. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
Amen.
God bless.